I'm actually a staff sergeant, John J. Nichols. I'm a master sergeant, but they didn't give it to me. And we're still fighting about that. So I'm staff sergeant John J. Nichols. I come from Colorado Springs, Colorado. I went in the military as soon as I turned 17.
Mm-hmm.
And that was March. I tried to get in March 1942. I mean in December,
mm-hmm.
the 8th. After Pearl Harbor, I was 16.
Mm.
They made me wait 4 months. And then me and my brother went and signed in. And I started my career at the fort. It's supposed to be Fort Riley. It was actually Camp Forsyth.
Mm-hmm.
Because they didn't have room for us in Fort Riley. And Funkston wouldn't allow us there because it was segregated. So they built prefab buildings up. And it was called Camp Forsyth. And that's where I began my training in June the 19th, 1942. I served with Jackie Robinson, who nobody knew played baseball, football, you know, from UCLA. That was on June the 20th. After we had the formation of calisthenics, we were stripped to the waist. We had to run 2 miles to a rock outcropping called the Rock, and we had to run back. And the late comers got put on detail. I wasn't worried. I was a very good athlete. I was leading the bird. And before I hit the finish line, I got passed out. And I got irritated with that, and the guy told me, said, "You're good, but he got you, he's better." I said, "I'll get in tomorrow." He said, "You know what, well, I don't care, I'll get in tomorrow." He said, "That's Jackie Robinson." I said, "Gee, Jackie Robinson?" And that intimidated me, because Jackie Robinson was one of the black heroes that we had during this era. And so I went around, I gawked at him, but he intimidated me, really.
Mm.
I was a country boy, never been away from home. And then in my next surprise came the next month. I don't remember the exact date and time or not, but it was in the first part of May, and the troop commander, Captain Evaldi, said, "I'm going to let you guys have a holiday, a half day off. We have a celebrity coming there." I said, "Well, we got Jackie Robinson, what are you?" He said, "No, Joe Louis, the world heavyweight champ, is coming." Oh, so everybody was out waiting for Joe to come in. Movie stars, actors, all title people out there getting the pictures, signature, autograph. And I was out there rubbing naked. And finally it dawned upon me, I better get back in and get my Buster Brown shoes shined. That's what we issued. Buster Brown's high top shoes and leggings. Up until you finish your horsemanship training, then you got your boots and your spurs. You pass your horsemanship. And so I was up there, and it got quiet, and all of a sudden I looked up, and everybody's looking at me. "What are you looking at me for?" And they said, "Yeah, you, Junior." I said, "Junior, you didn't call me out my name, or I was ready to fight." I looked over, and there was Joe Louis standing in the cadre room, had a towel around his midriff. He said, "Yeah, you, Junior, come here." So I walked over there. I was peeping at him. He said, "Go in there in my bunk and get some money, and go over to trading post, give me some comic books."
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, "Yes, sir." So I went in. I never saw so much money in my life. I was scared to death. World heavyweight champ. And I'm looking. And he came in and said, "Didn't I tell you to get some money?" He grabbed my hand. now get over and get him. I got this whole handful of money, scared to death. Don't know how much I got, because I've been trying to find maybe a $1 or $5 bill, something I could cope with. And so I went over and I tried. I picked out about what I thought was 10 best. I remember the Green Lantern was one, and Mandrake, the Magician, was the other one. I don't remember the rest of it. But anyway, so I marched back over there. I'm still holding on to all this money, because it didn't take much money to get the comic books. So I walked in and gave them to him. But he said, didn't I tell you to get some comic books? Get over and get them. So I went out, took two brothers, you and you come with me. We even though we got three stacks, yeah, that's what I'm talking about. And so I went to get the money, he said, send it to your mother. I don't know how he knew that I didn't know my father, and that, you know, somebody must have told him. But from then, that day forward, I became his gopher. And the next thing, high point in my life was they assigned him to with the first squad. And so Joe Lewis, he really wasn't a soldier per se. He was special service, you know. He kind of about the military. And so we were out drilling, and we're going into approaching a ditch of water. And Joe said, hut, two, or three. Oh. And so before I thought, I said to the rear porch. And boy, we spun away and we didn't get in the ditch. So he said, Junior, fall out. He called home and he said, take over. So from then on, I drilled his squad for him. And until I finished basic training. They called us in and said, Nichols, we need you to go to clerical school. And I was one of the few troopers that could read and write. But most of the guys came from the Cotton Patch and Texarkana, Texas, Georgia, and all. And most of them were illiterate. And so they sent me to clerical school. I began to clerk. I didn't like it because the captain was, he was sort of didn't get along,
yeah.
Because, see, I was happy for the first time in my life. I had new shoes, new clothes, clean bed. So, I'm in high cotton. I got new clothes, everything new. You know, top to bottom. I was just happy as a pig in slop, so to speak. So I walked in, and in the morning, I come in and whistle. Let's have that so-and-so whistling out there. First started looking, you know. So I told Tosh, I don't want to be in here, because he gonna rub me wrong and we're going to have it. He said, Nichols, you crazy. And I said, well, I don't like that. And he said, look, it takes people 9 years, 9, 10 years to make PFC. And here, you squawking, and we made you a spec four. I said, well, you can take it back. Now, I needed the money, but I knew I couldn't operate under that system. So he said, well, just get out here. So after a while, he called me in, and I told him, again, I don't want to stay in here. And so he said, well, you two will tell the captain something. He said, well, what do you want to do? I said, I want to go on the line. He said, you're too young. Nobody's going to take orders from you. And I said, you're going to stay where you are. All right. So he sent me down to barracks to carry a message. And I went in the first platoon, this is the first one, and I said, at ease in here. They kept on talking. I said, I said, at ease. They turned around and said, you little so-and-so, are you? I said, what'd you say? He said again, bam. I hit him in the midsection, he bent over, and I chopped him. And he went down, and his friend jumped over the footlocker, and I caught him in the same thing. His head hit one of the wooden footlockers. Blood spurted out. They carried him over to the hospital, dispensary, and the captain sent for me. He said, Nichols, you're a pain in the... I won't mention that. And he said, I'm going to court-martial you. I said, yes, sir. He said, I told you to deliver a message. I didn't tell you to go out there starting a fight. And I said, well, he said, at ease. He said, I'm court-martial you. I said, okay, sir. He said, he said some uncomplimentary things about my ancestry. And he said, you have one option. Article 15 or summary court-martial. And I said, well, what's Article 15? I wasn't really too familiar with the structure at this time. He said, Article 15 means I make the decision of what punishment you're going to get. And if you keep your nose clean, it will not be a matter of your record. I said, well, I'll take your punishment. I know what he's going to give me. He didn't care. He's going to give me something anyway. So he said, 30 days hard labor. I had to do duty all day, go eat, and then report. They came by, NCO and drilled us up to the stockade. Provost Marshal would come out, give you his little speech, then turn it over to Provost Sergeant, and he would assign what duty you have. Whether it was hour, 2 hours, all day, all night, but you had to, until reveille, you belonged to whatever detail they assigned you to. We went up there. So the Lord had his hands on me, but I was too dumb to know it. I didn't know him, and I wasn't looking for him either. I didn't like people who said they were Christian because they said one thing and did another. So I said, I don't need it. So, and my father was a so-called preacher, and he deserted my mother, so the credentials weren't very good. So I went on up there, and the provost sergeant came over. He said, who's the ranking non-commissioned officer we have here? Nobody raised their hand. He said, don't we have any NCOs here? Nobody raised their hand. There were 40 of us out there. He said, don't anybody have anything? He said, step forward. Who are you? What are you? I said, spec 4. He said, you're in charge. And this was my break. About 30 of the guys said, we're not working for that little old punk. He's not giving us no orders. And I said, take him on back. And I said, okay. So the 10 that would work, they drilled us over to squadron headquarters. And Major Perry is a beautiful officer. I never would forget him. And he came out, stood on a little porch in this little prefab building. And there was no grass or nothing up there because they just threw that up for us. And he came out, he said, who's in charge? I said, I am, sir. He said, what's your name? I told him, Nichols, sir. He said, okay, I'll show you what I want done. He said, he showed me. He said, now when you get through, you come in and tell me, I'll check it out, and I'll release you. Oh, yes, sir. So when they got through, doing the little, beautification stuff, grass, rocks, pulling up grass. So I went in and reported to him. He came out and said, you did a wonderful job there, Sergeant Nichols. He said that, Sergeant Nichols. And so I took him back over and I said, hey, we got time to do. Don't you dare go back up to the unit or socket. Meet, go in the movie. We had the movies for you. Sit in the back room before. They had advertisements. When they come, you get out of there and meet me at the oak tree, and then I'll take you over to stockade. Okay. So the next day, they heard about it, so 15 more of them joined. So the third day, the hardcore still was there. I said, don't even bring them out. They had 30 days to do when I got here. They'll have 30 days to do when I leave. So I took the other guy. So I got through, and so I went in and I told the first one, I said, I don't want to go back in the order room. In the meantime, he told me, you find somebody and train them to do your clerical work, and if the captain approves it, so I did. And so he called me and said, Nichols, you're a pain in my unmentionables. it was uncomplimentary, the things he had to say. And he said, all right. You train this guy, and if I approve him, we'll give him your spec 4, and you go out there as a private. I said, okay, sir. Deal. He said, you're stupid. I made no remark to that. I trained this guy. He weighed about 300 pounds. He hated the horse and he was afraid of them. The horses hated him. So I trained him. So I took him in, introduced him first start, and he said, take him in the captain. The captain checked him out. He said, he's acceptable. And I saw it. Meanwhile, my 30th day, my 30 days well. And I went in. And so he said, go ahead and type out your reduction. I said, okay, so I went in, typed out my reduction. Normally, the morning report went in at the beginning of the day. But I typed it out at night, got the captain's signature, so I just run her on up to squadron headquarters. And I walked in, he said, who is it? I said, Nichols. He said, come on in. Sergeant, I said, not sergeant, soon to be private. He said, what? He said, step outside. He picked up that old phone. He said, Cliff, what in the so-and-so's going on down there? If you don't need this man, I'll make him, I'll promote him right now. He's done the best job anybody did. Oh, and I heard Cliff, the captain, say, oh, there's some mistake. I could have slapped him. I said, you lying dog, I was thinking, I was angry, you know. He stood up in a line like that. And he said, send him back down there. So I walked in. He said, Nichols, you're a pain in my life. Some other uncomplimentary things. And he said, you know what I'm going to do with you? I said, no, sir. He said, I'm going to give you the worst platoon I got, 30 days. I'm going to let you keep that spec 4 for the 30 days. You make it, you can keep them. If you don't, I'm busting you. I said, deal, sir. So I went out and went over to first platoon. It was the worst platoon he had. And that's where I had to fight and got into trouble to begin with. Mm. So I went in there and I said, at ease. And they looked at me. I said, I'm the platoon sergeant from now on. They didn't like that. I didn't care. And so I walked around. I said, who's squad leader? First squad. I said, I am. I looked at him. I said, I looked at each body. I said, you have a first platoon, a first squad? He said, I think so. I said, you got it. I walked around and looked at him. First, I picked my file closer sergeant, who's the second in command. He brings up the rear. And he takes over in case something happens to me. The Sergeant Smith, he was a platoon sergeant before. He come in and said, well, I'll be your second command. I said, no, you won't. Pack your gear and move out, find your home. You're no longer in the platoon. Because if he couldn't handle them on his own, I knew he'd be a disruption to me. So I wasn't about to get into that. And some of the guys that felt loyal to him, they were going to be in trouble. So I sent him out. And if anybody else want to leave, so I took over. So then Thursday, Captain Lippincott called me and said, Nichols, I didn't believe you could do it. Here, put these on. He threw me staff sergeant stripes. They issued us the old plugs from the 11th Cav. And they were hard mouth, old beat up plugs. The black troops got the worst and the least of it, if any. And the same thing with horses. General T.K. Brown said, you're not going to treat my troopers that way. He formed a remount squad. And they went out and captured Mustangs. That was wild Mustangs.
Wow.
And we broke them and trained them. Oh. And I'd been just made sergeant, so I named my horse Sergeant. And I trained him. I wouldn't go on pass or leave or nothing. I stayed and trained my horse. I broke him. I saddle blanket, broke him. The Indians have a way of doing that. You don't throw a saddle on him and hop on board. You go in and you get familiar with him first. So you have to rope him. And I put oats in a can and shake it. And I'd rope him, pull him up to me, and he's tired and all that. Because all he knew from these were remounts. See, they had gone out and captured horses and do it the hard. It's the right way in the army way and the wrong way. The army way is the wrong way. They treat the wrong way all the time. And they would take this horse in, and he's afraid of man. The man smell. Mm-hmm. You throw him down. You clip him. You click on his fetlocks, and you use the clippers. Show the shed here. And these are clippers making all that noise, and you had to twitch him. And, because the horse is scared to death. So everything that happened to him, then they have the audacity that you had to cut the hair on the neck and brand them there with a serial number, which is painful. And then they would take him and let him run out wild for a whole year. Now you go out and capture and bring him back, now you're supposed to train him. That's the dumbest thing in the world. Instead of keeping it going while you have it. So I said, I'm not going through that. I'm not going to be fighting with this horse. So I went out, I roped him. The way, when they brought him in on the train, and the horse, if you ever been on a ship, you know, you get your sea legs. Well, that's the way the horse is. He's drunk from swaying in them 40 and 48s. And he come in, and I saw this one. There were two horses had markings out like. Both of them had blazes, four-quarter stockings. I looked them over, and I said, I want one of them. Well, unfortunately, when the horses came in, the CO got the first one. The officers got theirs. The master sergeant, first sergeant, got theirs. Then came the platoon sergeant, then came the troopers. Well, I knew that sergeant, somebody was going to take my horse. So I went out and roped him and went back, and I gave the guy on stable police, I said, hey, put him in a sick stall. There are sick stalls there. That those horses run on sick car, you know. And I bribed him to put him in there until they made the selection. And so the captains ordered it, and they were down looking, and he was looking at, there were two horses with the same marker. The way I chose mine, all the rest of them were standing there trying to get their sea leg. This one was trying to I said, that horse has spear. I'll take him. And that's what I took. And so after they had clipped him, and then a listed man couldn't have a mane or a long tail. And so they, since he was clipped and all, then I got him assigned to me. So I'd go out there, I'd put oats in the can, I'd take it out there and shake it, and I'd call him. And he wouldn't come, I'd rope him, pull him to me, talk to him. You know, I put a little sugar in the oats, and I kept on, so I'd come out, I'd shake it, Sergeant! Come in, Sergeant, come in! And after a while, he got to walk slowly to me. Then he would trot to me. I got to, yeah, boy, he comes over. I kept oats in my pocket, and we carried oats anyway. Put your spurs in it, kept them shy. I trained him, so I'd go in and I gently by talking to him, and I'd rub him down. I took a horse blanket and I put my smell on him. I didn't hate the shy. I kept with him until he would accept that. Then I'd rub him down so he got familiar with smell and me. And then I got to start leaning on him. It's that long process. But I took the time. I had this little old plug in the meantime that I was still riding. So I would talk to him and gentlemen. And then finally I would put the horse blanket on him. And then I'd lean and lean over on him until he got used to that. And then I would put the saddle on him. Then came the bridle. Well, he liked that bridle too much, so we had quite a little talk about that. And I'd give him oats, you know, reward him. And he liked the rewards. So he got so, I could call him. You know, incidentally, I'm 90 and I forgot, I can't whistle no more. It's really irritating. And nobody ever told me that. But anyway, so I'd pucker up and I'd whistle at him. And he'd trot over to me. and I'd walk him and he'd rub, you know. This was an asset to me. See, I always heard and watched him play polo. I wanted to play polo. Mm-hmm. Now, here's a Polish kid on the block wants to play polo. And only officers and gentlemen. Now, first three graders up could play polo. So, and I chose sergeant because I knew from horses that a quarter horse will make a polo horse because he has to be able to turn on the quarter and give you 15 cents change. Because you have to cut. You have to be able to cut in, squat in. So I trained him and I wanted to play polo. Never got to play polo. Before that happened, he chipped his camp locket and took our horses away from us, said, you have to go in action, it's dismounted. That was a lie. They were planning to disband us all along. They took our horses away from us, and I said, uh-oh, I smell something. And it happened when we got to the Task Blank in North Africa in Maine. They told us, we don't need no combat troops. We need war troops. I said, well, you better send me on home. He said, well, I said, you better send me. I can't even fight. I'm coming to work. I'm going to work for you. He said, you crazy? But I trained to fight. I was hard with my men. I'm going to fight. Well, I said, well, I'm going to fight somebody. So it could be you or the enemy or you. I don't care which. There's going to be a fight, and there was, so they put me in a stockade, and I didn't care. And they would put me in a hole in the ground. They said, Nichols! I said, we'll give you a hot meal if you go to, when you go to work. I said, you know what you can do with that? You went on back in the hole. And so I never did. I never did. I just was determined to fight her. Just send me home. I said, this will get the whole concept. Just let me go home. No, you're going to stay here. I said, you're asking for trouble. And they got it, and I got it too. I didn't care. So finally they said, the black newspaper, let our boys in there, let our boys in there. And then some of the other people said, hey, our boys are getting shot up, and they've got over there selling cigarettes and stuff. They rallied, let some of them go in there. So they said, well, we have to see if they can fight. That's the coolest, you know, what and where. Because that's all we ever did was fight by nature for survival. But anyway, they said, well, we'll have to try it. They sent the 370 combat team they were infantry. And So the 370 combat team came in. See, the 101st Airborne got in the Battle of Bastogne. They got surrounded. They were getting eliminated. So they were trying to get them out. 761st said, we'll get them out. So they go in and get them. They did. Took heavy casualties, and they took it. So they came to stop there and said, Nichols, if you'll fight, we'll let you out. I said, that's the reason I'm here. So I came out, and I went to the infantry. Well, they got even with me. See, we used to follow dog faces and all that, you know. And it was a lot of, you know, in the military, there's competitiveness, unity, pride, you know. If I said something about your group or company, we'd go to duke it out. Right. We'd go to duke the city. Right. And so we had teased you guys, so they, now here I am, this month of Cavalry, I'm getting it back. And boy, did they whip it on me. Well, I was I specialize in operating behind the enemy lines. That's what I like to do. I like to be out on my own. I don't like to have somebody else's eyes. And decisions. I make my own. And so I was recon specialist. And so I got in there and they wouldn't sign me the 370. Now, the 370 incident, they came over and there's a river traverses Italy north south. Mm-hmm. And fuming auto number. And nobody could take it. So they gave 270 that combat team, and they took it. And through their casualties, they needed replacements, and I'd come out. That's where I wanted to go, to spearhead. They sent me the 365th infantry. I said, okay. But I'd lead the patrols at night, you know. And I did that until the war ended. And then I went home, and but when we went, we were supposed to have a parade in New York, and that never happened.
Did you ever do any tank duty?
Tank?
Yeah, tank.
No, I didn't like tanks. You had your little patents, and they were no match for the Tigers.
Right.
Not at all. Right. We didn't have none going until the service got there.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Because they'd run around like little dogs, keeping around it. Boom, they'd blown away.
Mm.
And I didn't like tanks. The tanks got more shrapnel than my head.
They converted the cavalry to the tanks.
Huh?
They converted the cavalry to the tanks.
No.
Slowly but surely.
Well, there's some of them, but I didn't have that option.
You didn't okay.
They just messed up because I was so obstinate. And I wouldn't have went anyway. Well, I would have taken anything, but I wasn't going to work.
Right.
The secret. But now, your tank. The only thing I found tanks good for was hitch a ride for
and deep muddy.
Deep muddy. Because they came up online, the airmail would be going over. And doing all right. But here they come. Boom! Boom! For about 10 salvos move out.
Uh-huh.
CPOP would pick up the spot, start throwing stuff in there on you. That's how I got my shrapnel.
Mm.
So I said, don't gonna keep them things away from me. I wouldn't leave the position. And I had the aid man come in and fix it, the man did it up.
Mm.
And I forgot all about it. So I never went to the hospital or anything. And I didn't realize I had it. And the doctor here told me, I put in my claim, they said, you got shrapnel in there. And I said, I don't. He said, you got shrapnel. Well, every time I try to fly, they would pull me out because I told them about the knee replacement. But they said, no, it's not the knee. And I had to do everything but bend and you know what. And every time I fly now. So then I got to thinking, and I remembered, oh man, it's not a matter of your record. So now they won't accept it. So I said, all right. The infantry wouldn't give me any accolades. I was supposed to get a Silver Star. They downgraded to the bronze and then didn't give me nothing. I said, okay, I didn't come in and get no medals no more. And so I never got that. In fact, they didn't even give me the good conduct. I saw my first jet in 1944. It was up in the same area at Castle de Fulta. And two aircraft came over, and the jet streams were coming out. So we thought they'd been hit by gunfire and was going to crash in the back. So we did knee-deep snow up at the Fulta. And we struggled over there and got over there, no aircraft. And then we found out the next day, the next couple of days, started crashing out the German jets.
Wow.
We didn't even know they had
it.
Wow.
We
didn't know where the jet was. But then the war ended, and I went back home. My fiance had moved up to somebody else. I didn't get to their job. So I was mean. I ended up, it was suggested I leave. So I went back and I stayed in the army as long as I stayed abroad. I was born 30. I started to change. I couldn't keep up with the change. They're still working on change. one, here comes chain three. Come mm. said, look, I can have them. And the guy told you couldn't do your job.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He assigned me to Fort Knox, Kentucky, mm-hmm. where I didn't want to go because I didn't think.
Yeah.
And so I had to give instruction on wheel vehicle. And so I had to learn it so I could go teach the guy next day. So I'd be up after that, learning that. Had to make my own training aid, had to drill. It was just, I said, I told John, Joe, Will, I can have